Now, can you really call yourself a Linux superuser if you don't know how to use these 10 essential commands? In this video, I'm going to cover the 10 essential commands I think you need to know to be a Linux superuser. This is going to separate the novices from the pros. And don't worry, I'm going to walk you through it safely to make sure there are no accidental system crashes here. Naturally, our journey has to begin with sudo. Of course, right? You can't be superuser without sudo. So this command essentially gives you godlike powers over your system, letting you install software, edit system files, and more. With great power obviously comes great responsibility. Here you go, here's the sudo command. Obviously, non-superusers will be using this as well. But as a superuser, you'll be using sudo all the time, naturally. So I'm going to use this to open up the fstab file. And this is how we control how disks are mounted, and it's a very sensitive file. So I'm just going to be looking for now. I'm not going to make any changes. I don't want to stop my system from booting. And of course, if you make any changes, please back up critical files before touching them with sudo. So I'm going to use sudo nano editor, and I'm going to open up the fstab file, fstab, depending on how to pronounce it. And here we go. This is how we can control how disks are mounted on my system. Of course, just looking, no changes. But as a superuser, this is something that you would find yourself doing. So become familiar with using the fstab file, and of course using sudo, which is the main point. The sudo command is the backbone of being a superuser. So let's move out of this now and carry on. Of course, being a superuser also means that we control permissions to files, and using the chmod or chmod command is essential. We use the chmod command to be able to change the permissions to files. And in this case, I'm going to change the permissions of file to 700. This is going to lock out anybody but the file owner from reading, writing, or executing the file I'm going to select. This is great for securing sensitive files or scripts. Now, of course, by restricting access, whilst this is great for protecting private files, I have to be extra careful, because if I've got system critical files, I can prevent other users or services from accessing them, and that would be a bad thing. So in this case, I'm going to be changing the my script file. And then I can use my ls command to verify that. And here we can see when I look at this row that the read, write, and execute is only for myself. So that has worked. Now, if you're unfamiliar with using permissions such as 700, or you're unfamiliar with the idea of permissions in general, of course, superuser status requires this. So I'd encourage you to read into this, understand how changing these binary bits for different users and groups, etc., for controlling permissions works, because this is an essential part of being a Linux superuser. So let's now move on. So process control is also an essential part of being a Linux superuser. When you've got rogue processes hogging resources, you need to know what's going on. And we can use psaugs to figure out what's running. And we can also pipe this and use something like grep to filter for certain processes. And when we found out what's going on, we can then use killall to terminate any of these rogue processes. So I'm going to start off by using psaugs, and I'm going to pipe this to grep. And I'm going to filter for Apache 2. So if you're running a web server, this might be something you would do. And there you go, I've got some Apache 2 processes running. I'm going to assume these are rogue processes. They're running wild and they're hogging resources. So the next step for me is to use sudo and then the killall command for Apache 2. And this is going to terminate all of those commands. And if I rerun my psaugs, I can now see they are gone. Exercise caution here. We don't want to use killall on critical processes like networking, because this could cause serious issues. So a superuser knows when and when not to use something like killall. But when it is time to go, it's a very powerful process. And combining with psaugs helps us track down the troublemakers and exercise great process control. Now let's talk about networking and IP tables, because firewalls are essential for network security, because security is key, and making changes to firewall rules can block your internet access and expose your system. So you need to proceed with caution when you're looking at something like IP tables. But knowing how to use this file, knowing how to use IP tables, is a key part of being a superuser and a network master of Linux. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to use my sudo command. I'm going to simply use the IP tables command, and I'm going to use a capital L to just list them. So this capital L flag will list all the rules, and there we go. This controls the traffic. This is the traffic flow into and out of the system, protecting it from unwanted access, and I'm just listing the rules here. Of course, firewalls are essential, and modifying rules incorrectly could either block your network access or leave your system vulnerable. So you need to learn how to use these when wanting to make these edits. But as a superuser, I'm sure you are already hungry to learn about networking, and using IP tables will be a key part of a superuser's day-to-day. Now let's talk about managing disks and partitions. This is, again, essential for any superuser, but be careful. This command could wipe your drives if you don't use it properly. And we're going to use the fdisk command with a lowercase l flag to just list all the disk partitions. All I'm doing here is listing, and it will give a detailed view of all available disks and their partitions, but I'm not going to make any changes, because any accidental changes or modifying the partitions could lead to data loss or an unbootable system, and I don't really want that. So fdisk, lowercase l this time instead of capital L for IP tables, and I'm now listing all the disks and their partitions. Very simple, but again, as a superuser, managing disks and partitions is a key part of your job. Now I'm going to talk about using the mount command. This is how we mount file systems. And this is a key skill for superusers. And in this case, I'm going to give you a little bit of a demo. I'm going to mount a disk using a loopback device. This allows us to treat a file like a real disk. But before we do that, we can make sure everything's set up properly. So I'm going to give you a little bit of precursor for diving in and using the mount, and then obviously the umount to unmount the disk. So to begin with, I'm going to look for some free loopback devices. Loop A is free, fantastic. So now I'm going to use the dd command, and I'm going to use this to create a virtual disk. And essentially, I'm going to fill this up just with 10 megabytes in size and the pre-created disk command. So here we go. Excellent. Now I want to attach the loopback device. I'm going to attach it to loop 8, which we can see there. So I've already created the command. So we're good with loop 8. Off we go. And now the next thing we need to do is that we've attached the disk to loop 8, and it tells us to treat it like an actual disk. And we'll be able to access it through loop 8, just like we would a real USB drive or external drive. But now we need to mount, before we can mount the disk, we need to mount it with a valid file system. So I'm going to use mkfs, and I'm going to use ext4x4 to create a file system on this image, because without the valid file system, the mount command will fail. So the idea is I'm creating a virtual disk and I'm going to mount it. This is all a demo for mount, but to make sure that this works, I need to make sure it's got the correct file system. So let's just use this command. There we go. We've now created the file system, and we are now ready to use our mount command. And I'm going to mount, what is that, dev/loop8 to /mnt. Here we go. And we have now mounted our file system. Excellent. And if you want to verify the mount, you can simply use the ls command. And there we go, loss+found. So we have been able to verify that our disk was successfully mounted. Now, of course, mounting disks seems super simple. If you're used to Windows, you just plug it in and off you go, right? But in Linux world, knowing how to mount and unmount disks properly is an essential command for any super user. So once we've mounted it, the final step is to unmount it. Now, the command sometimes looks like it should say unmount, but it is umount. So we simply use sudo umount, not unmount, umount. This will unmount it. And then we can also make sure we free back up that loop 8 just to tidy up after we've done everything now. So there we go. We've cleaned up. Now, this has been a slightly more complicated process. And in fact, again, super user land, this is the kind of things that we have to do. We've created a virtual disk. We've mounted it to loopback, or we've put it on loopback, then mounted it to MNT, and we've unmounted it. But the point here is that as a super user, knowing how to mount and unmount disks is an essential part of your day-to-day life. Now let's talk about adding and changing users. This is user management. And obviously as a super user, you get to control who gets access to the system. So I want to add a new user and give them admin privileges. And it's really easy. I just use the user add command. So I could use sudo, user add, let's create elite user. There we go. We've now created elite user. Now, what do we want to do after that? We want to set their password. So we're going to use sudo password, and that's passwd, not the full password, elite user, and let's create a password, and this password is just going to be okay, and we have now updated their password. Excellent. So we've created a user and given them a password. Now what we want to do, we want to give them admin privileges, and the way that we do this is we use the user mod command. Okay, so what I'm going to do after setting their password, I'm going to add them to the sudo group, which will give them admin privileges. All right, so now I've got this command ready to go. So we've got sudo user mod ag sudo elite user. And there we go. That user has now been added to the admin group and now has admin privileges. Now, of course, managing users is essential for security, and you wouldn't want to accidentally lock yourself out or give too many people admin access. So knowing how to use user add and user mod is not only important from a functional perspective, but understanding proper user management is a key part of being a super user. So get into these commands, get used to it. User management is a key part of super user and system admin life. Now, why do we want to do repetitive tasks manually when you can automate them with cron? Well, you wouldn't, would you? You'd set up a cron job to automate tasks. And cron tab is an excellent way to automate tasks like a pro. Now, what I'm going to do is I can open up the cron tab file to edit, or to rather schedule a task. And we can set up a simple task to echo hello into a log file every minute. Elite users automate everything from backup to logging. But of course, be careful, because misconfigured jobs can overload your system if they run too frequently. So understanding how to set the wildcard properly for cron is simple once you get your head around it, but an important part of being a super user. So we could simply use this command. We could use sudo cron tab e for edit, and now no cron tab for root, using an empty one, and we can use this select an editor, nano, vim. I'm going to go with nano. Nano seems fine. And we are now inside the file. And now if we wanted to, we could simply copy this out. So what have we got here? We're going to move down to a free line, and we go. We're going to echo hello Linux to the cronlog.txt, and notice that we've got two carrots here, which means we're appending, not overwriting. If you're not used to cat and appending and overwriting, that might be confusing for a super user, obviously very standard. And now we're going to echo this out to this file every minute. If I want to save this, I've got to use Control O in nano, yes, to accept the file, Control X, and now we've created our cron job. Fantastic. So cron is one of those simple things that once you wrap your head around, it's incredibly powerful for automating, and super users automate all the time. So getting familiar with cron and cron tab is an excellent part of becoming a super user. Okay, systemctl. This command is essential. This is how we control system services. And managing services is one of the most important things that a superuser does. Now, this is obviously the tool for the job, and it allows you to start, stop, restart, enable, and disable services. And these are background processes running the system. I'm going to use systemctl to restart the networking service. Now, this is a tool used to manage system services like networking, firewalls, or web servers. And of course, this also means we've got to be extra careful because stopping critical services like networking could disconnect you, restart. Certain services could also cause system-wide disruptions. So you've got to think about what's going on when exercising this type of command. And to do it, we'd simply type out sudo systemctl. That is our command. I'm going to say restart, and I'm going to say networking. If I were then to click enter, this would restart networking on my computer. So let's give it a go. Failed to restart. Service wasn't found. So there we go. I have now looked for a service that isn't there. So make sure you look for a service that does exist when you want to use this. Let's see what the service should be for this. Now, of course, what I should have remembered is that we're in a newer version of Ubuntu with this demo. And of course, I want to run this command networking is going to work. I've got to use network manager. Let's try that one more time. Sudo systemctl. We've got that written on it. Systemctl restart the network manager. Give that a go. And that has now worked, and the network has restarted on my system. I can see it in the top right-hand corner. Super users, of course, we remember as many commands as possible. We also know that things move and change with the times, and sometimes we've got to look up what the updated command is, and in this case, it was network manager. But bearing in mind, the most important part of this demo is that using systemctl is great for managing services, but of course, be careful because stopping any critical services could disconnect you, could mess up your system, and could wreak havoc. So like all of these super user commands, knowing how to use them is essential, but knowing how to use them when and where and properly is the most important part. Now let's wrap up with backing up, because backing up is an essential part of being a super user, and the rsync command makes it very easy for us to do this. And what we could do is we could simply sync directories to a backup location while preserving permissions and timestamps. So I'm going to use this to backup my Linux demo folder to a backup location, and the A flag preserves file permissions and timestamps while the V provides detailed output. Now elite users automate backups with rsync, but always double check your path to avoid overwriting important data. So how about we use rsync? We've got our A and V flag. I'm going to backup the Linux demo directory. I'm going to back it up to, we're going to call it, how about we just call it Linux demo, lowercase d, Linux demo backup. Simple as that. Click go. And there we go. We have created our backup. Now, backing up seems super simple, but it's an essential part of being a system admin and a super user. So again, the rsync command makes it super easy. And you could, of course, automate this with a script, throw it into cron tab, combine all of your stuff together, and therefore you're not running these things manually. You're actually making it even more efficient. And that's something that I would then finish this video off with, to say that all of these commands individually allow you to do a lot of things, but the power of being a super user is often creating your own scripts, and these scripts contain commands within them. These commands get combined together, piped together, turn into more complicated sets of processes, and then you will run these and automate them with things like cron to ensure that everything happens seamlessly behind the scenes. But you as a super user are the architect of using all these commands properly, using them at the right time, and using them to appropriately manage your system. And that's it. That's 10 Linux super user commands that I think separate the pros from the novices. Hope you've learned some new tricks. Feel free to take on your system like a true Linux master, but of course, be careful. Always back things up. Be cautious when making changes, especially if you're new. Maybe even use a virtual machine or VMware or something to isolate yourself from your actual machine if you want to learn to use these and not create any real damage to your own system. But I hope you've enjoyed this. As always, please feel free to leave comments, and I can't wait to see you in the next video.